Let's go on with the Upanishads commentary. This one is about the undivided, unmoving self. And they wrote the following. The teachings of the Upanishads are the supreme expressions of the eternal wisdom, the eternal vision of the Vedic seers. Consequently, though simple in their mode of expression, they can be extremely hard to grasp. The rishis lived in a state of consciousness almost opposite to that of most of us, but it is possible of attainment, and so the wise cultivate it. Yet we need guidance along the way and need to carefully look into the Upanishadic dicta for that guidance. There are many things that we need not know, but the truths embodied in the Upanishads and their inspired summary, the Bhagavad Gita, must be known by all who would ascend to higher life, so they merit our intent consideration. The four levels of understanding. During the last week of his earthly life, Jesus was in Jerusalem at the Passover season. At one point while speaking to the crowd, he prayed, "Father, glorify thy name." There came there a voice from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." The people therefore that stood by and heard it said that it thundered. Others said an angel spake to them. And of course a third contingency heard nothing. This is how it is in the world of unreality when reality impinges on it. According to the level of development, so the encountering individual reacts to the impingement. In Indian philosophy there are a lot of numerical divisions, but one of the most prevalent is that of four. To list some, there are four ages of human history. There are four modes of consciousness, waking, dreaming, dreamless, sleep, and Tarija, consciousness itself. There are four stages of dharmic life, student, family, semi-solitary, and monastic. Of course, there are four castes. All of these relate to the evolutionary development of the individual and are fundamentally a matter of internal disposition and capacity. These four levels are depicted in this event. Some people heard what was spoken and knew it was the voice of God. Some heard a voice, not the actual words, and thought it was an angel speaking. Some heard an indistinct sound and thought it was thunder. And others, no doubt the majority, heard nothing at all. It is not an event that matters as much as our comprehension of it. Yes, that is everything, comprehension. And that takes place only according to our state of inner development. Krishna spoke of this in the beginning of his instruction to Arjuna at the Kurukshetra, saying there are some who have actually looked upon the Atman and understood it in all its wonders. Others can only speak of it as wonderful beyond their understanding. Others know of its wonders by hearsay, and there are others who are told about it and do not understand a word. Here again are the four levels of comprehension. We pass from one to another in ascending steps only through inner cultivation, in other words, only through meditation. But meditation supported by an entire way of life that facilitates it, in other words, dharma. For if there is neither the practice nor the support for the practice, little will result in the way of developing consciousness. And if consciousness is not developed, the teachings of the great sages will be little understood by us, and perhaps greatly misunderstood, or just not understood at all. Sri Ramakrishna told about a certain group of yogis who were wont to challenge a person with the words, "What station are you dwelling in?" By station they meant the habitual state of the individual's mind. The next verse of the Isha Upanishad is not easy to grasp because it speaks of a mode of being far different from our usual condition. So it will be a real test as to what station of consciousness we are dwelling in as we try to decode it. Here it is. The self is one. Unmoving, it moves swifter than thought. The senses do not overtake it, for it always goes before. Remaining still, it outstrips all that run. Without the self, there is no life. The self is one. One has two meanings in Eastern thought. One, number, and second, quality. This is a very important point, since many controversies have arisen philosophically simply because Western thinkers tend to limit one to a numerical value only. The incredible bitter and violent controversy over the so-called monophysite heresy in early Christianity, in which tens of thousands of Egyptians and Syrians were killed by the armies of the Byzantine Empire, took place only because the Italian Byzantines could not grasp what the heretics meant by the simple word monos when applied to spiritual matters. Both meanings, number and quality, have significance for us who like the four kumaras, or intent on the knowing of the self. The principle that the self is one should set us to thinking about our own present self-concept, and perhaps even more important, the way we live out our self-concept. Many people think one thing intellectually and think another instinctively. For example, I knew a minister who was once challenged by a self-styled atheist who spent about an hour expounding the truth of atheism and the folly of theism. When he was finished, the minister said, "There are 2 points about all that you have just said. One, it is complete nonsense. Two, you do not believe a word of it yourself." The man threw his right hand up in the air and declared, "I swear to God in heaven that I do." Somewhere I've already mentioned that an Eastern Christian theological student once remarked to me that the worst thing that had ever happened to Western Christianity and Western philosophy in general was the invention of the pie chart. Those round diagrams divided into slices that plagued us throughout school in many subjects, from mathematics to sociology. People have come to think that they are conglomerations of pieces that make up a whole, rather than a single homogeneous being. He explains, "How many times do people speak of having several roles in life, or of wearing many hats? Fragmentation is a terrible plague, destroying our capacity to either see or attain unity, integration of our being. We think it is all right to be multiple persons. Where this all began with us is buried in the past, but the present reality cannot be denied. Drawn out from our center of unity, we say, I am a businessman, a spouse, a parent, a citizen, etc., rather than I'm a single person who functions in the area of business, marriage, parenthood, citizenship, etc. This no small thing, and certainly not merely a philosophical nicety. This is a serious mental and spiritual disorder, being both fragmented and dispersed in our energies and awareness, rather than operating from a central point of order. The mirror of our life is shattered into innumerable fragments that cannot convey any coherent image of our face. The unity that is the true image is broken. It's completely defaced and even erased as far as our consciousness is concerned, even though our true nature can never be altered in any manner. Struggling and submerged in the illusion of multiplicity, the truth of our unity is far from us. For we are not just one numerically, we are absolutely one in nature. This is an eternal truth that must be regained by us. How to do so? By the only process that really unifies the consciousness, meditation. Unmoving, it moves swifter than thought. How can the self move swifter than thought and yet be unmoving? This is not some cone-like platitude meant to phase our mind in realization to self-knowledge. It is simple fact. The self, the spirit, is completely outside of time and space, which are illusions anyway, yet it can scan time and space, moving backward and forward simply because of the fact that it is one. Being one in a truest sense, the self is everywhere, since there really is no where at all. The self is truly whole and therefore all-embracing. It moves swifter than thought because a thought requires a time, however small, to arise or be expressed. The self, in contrast, exists only in the now. The question, where did I come from, where am I going, what was I in the past, and what shall I be in the future, are valuable because they set us on the quest to the discovery that we do not come or go, nor do we have a past or future, only a present. When Sri Ramana Maharshi was at the end of his physical embodiment, he commented, "They say I am going, but where shall I go?" Some years later, Sri Anandamaya Ma visited Ramanashram. When the Maharshi disciples asked her to stay there, feeling that in her they had revived their guru, she simply remarked, "I neither come nor go." This is true of us all as well. The senses do not overtake it, for it always goes before. The self does not move, but it is always before. Some of these words are really tricky for me to pronounce. I'm not gonna lie, as I'm narrating all of this, like this one, the Mandakya Upanishad. We're talking about Eastern, like, metaphysics, physics and philosophy here. That's kind of tricky, but I hope you're still keeping up with everything that's being shared here, even though it sounds kind of out of the mind compared to the Western world. The Mandakya Upanishad, speaking of the consciousness of the self, of Turiya, describes it as not subjective experience, nor objective experience, nor experience intermediate between these two, nor is it a negative condition, which is neither consciousness nor unconsciousness. It is not the knowledge of the senses, nor is it relative knowledge, nor yet inferential knowledge, beyond the senses, beyond the understanding, beyond all expression. It is pure unitary consciousness, wherein awareness of the world and of multiplicity is completely obliterated. It is infallible peace. It is supreme good. It is one without a second. It is the self, known alone. Who can say any more? Remaining still, it outstrips all that run. The self is unmoving, as we have been told. Hence, any moment is incompatible with it and blots it from our awareness. That which moves cannot possibly perceive it, nor can any process of movement, including the labyrinthine ways of so much yoga, ever result in touching or seeing it. Rather, movement must cease, as Patanjali points out in the very beginning of the Yoga Sutras. Yoga is the cessation of movement in the mind substance. In other words, when we stop running, we will rest in ourself. We may engage in frantic activity, running here and there, and accomplishing tremendous things, indulging the senses to the maximum, and immersing ourselves in ambitions, emotions, and relationships. But through it all, the truth is simply this: we are dead, mere wraiths feeding desperately on a shadow life that is no life at all, not even a poor imitation. In the self alone do we find life. How hard this is to learn, and how much harder it is to follow, for it inevitably leads to the total renunciation of all that is not the self. In other words, to the renunciation of everything we hold dear and identify with as being ours and ourself, when they are no such thing at all. This is a bitter insight in the beginning, but as our inner eye begins to adjust to the truth of it, we find the source of greatest joy. When a man has achieved non-attachment, self-mastery, and freedom from desire through renunciation, he reaches union with Brahman, who is behind all action. A great deal is involved when we sincerely pray, "Lead me from death to immortality." And that was the end of the commentary for this section. Again, a lot of information to contemplate in our own time and in our own way. Though the whole basic premise that there is no life outside of self is absolutely fascinating, because you can actually touch this indeed through meditation. We're so busy getting things and doing things, physically speaking, that we're totally unaware of this inner universal one life from which we actually sprang. The more we learn to connect and sense that, the better life will actually become, obviously, because you have found the source and power behind all of creation itself. But it can only be accessed through meditation and deep contemplation. So if you have never experienced it so far for yourself, well, they gave you the way. It's through meditation, taking the time to enter within yourself, to go beyond what the senses are all telling you right now. Because they usually keep us busy with all sorts of activities that are all of a temporary nature at the end of the day. We want to seek out the eternal nature of life, and we find it within, beyond all this physical stuff. Now, if you're new to this channel, consider subscribing to receive inspirational videos on a regular basis. And with that being said, dear viewer, never forget that we are the dreamers.